All right, good morning, folks. My name's Bob Calloway. I'm with NetApp, and I'm kind of going to be your MC for this morning. Want to quickly start with a who's who of who we have up here. So we'll go down the line and introduce folks.
Hello. So, hey, I'm Robert Esker. I'm the product manager for OpenStack at NetApp.
Hello. I'm Tushar Katarki. I'm from Red Hat.
Hi, I'm Greg Elkenbard. I'm senior technical director from Mirantis.
Hi, I'm Xin Yang. I'm a technologist from the CTO office at EMC.
Hi, good morning. I'm Shamal Tahir, EMC.
Hi, I'm Ben Swartzlander. I am the PTL for the Manila project, and I work for NetApp.
Hi, I'm Dean Hildebrand, and I'm a research manager at IBM Almaden.
So as you can tell, we've got a wide variety of vendors. Some would consider us friends, and some would consider us foes. But the point of the project here is that it's not a, Manila is a community effort. We've got a wide variety of folks, even outside of the folks we have up here on the virtual stage, I guess. That are participating within the Manila project. So we wanted to give you a very cross-vendor view of not just what the function is, but what different companies are doing to integrate in with Manila. So we'll give you an overview of what is Manila from a very basic level. We'll quickly jump to a demonstration of walking you through a fairly simple use case of creating shares, attaching shares, whatnot. We'll talk about the API, kind of what are the key concepts and constructs that people deal with. Ben will talk about kind of the little bit under the covers, what's the architecture look like, what are some of the challenges that are unique to a file share as a service offering. Then we'll go through each of the vendors, and they'll talk through some of the details of how they've integrated their products within Manila, give you a little bit of kind of where the project's at, where we're going to be going during the Juno timeframe, and then hopefully have time for a few questions at the end. So with that, I'll turn it over to Jing.
So what is Manila? Manila is a project that provides multi-tenant, secure shared file systems as a service in OpenStack. Just like Cinder, which provides persistent block storage for instances, Manila provides access to shared file systems for instances. There are some commonalities between Cinder and Manila, as both are dealing with storage. However, there are some significant differences between the two. While Cinder does not have knowledge about networking, Manila needs to know a lot about individual tenant networks. Cinder relies on hypervisors to manage attaching, detaching volumes. Manila, on the other hand, routes around the hypervisor, and it connects the storage with the instances directly. So Manila needs to handle user access control and permissions assignment, and it needs to deal with security and authentication. Manila supports NFS and CIFS protocols today, and more protocols will be supported in the future. So here's a diagram that shows a Manila use case in an OpenStack cloud. There are two requests coming from the orchestration layer. The first one wants to provide access to guests 1 and 7 to the existing R&D file share. And the second one wants to create a new file share for marketing and provide access to guests 6 and 8. So Manila enables and automates this process. It makes it easy for guests to have access to the file shares through isolated tenant networks. According to the 2012 IDC report, the file storage accounts for over 65% of total disk capacity in 2012. And file-based storage continues to be a thriving market. Spending on file-based storage solutions is expected to reach $34.6 billion in 2016. Without automation, it is very difficult to provision and manage shared file systems. And customers will have to work around the problem by scripting or automation themselves. Manila, which provides shared file systems as a service, automates the process, and it makes it easy for guests to have access to the file systems. It facilitates the management and provisioning of the shared file systems in an OpenStack cloud. Manila has become an independent project since June last year, and since then, companies including NetApp, Mirantis, Red Hat, EMC, and IBM have been working on it, and lots of progress has been made since then. If you're interested in Manila and want to learn more about it, you can visit the OpenStack Manila wiki page. Manila is ready for download today. It's available at this website, github.com/stackforge-manila. You can also join us on IRC, and the IRC channel is openstack-manila.
So now what we'll do is we'll show you a quick demo of what it looks like. So we'll kind of cover the high-level concept of what it is, but I always find it useful to perhaps see it in action. So again, we're starting with this scenario where we've got the desire to create a new share as well as provide access to existing shares. So you can see here we've got two shares that already exist, both a finance share as well as a research and development share. They're already done within the same construct within Horizon that you would typically see volumes and instances, so it looks and feels as if it's a native object within the overall OpenStack framework. So what we'll do is, since we already have a couple shares existing, we want to provide access to those shares to particular guest instances. So we'll look at guests 1, 6, 7, and 8. They have IP addresses of 10.0.0.2, 4, 5, and 6. So the first thing that we'll do is we'll click over to the Shares tab. We'll look at the Shares network. You'll notice here that the share network that we've defined is how the NFS and CIFS exports that are exposed by the backend storage subsystems are actually then tied into the networks that are utilized by the instances. So in this case, we have a Neutron network called private with a private subnet. And then we'll quickly switch here over to the graphical view for Neutron, showing that the instances are hanging off of the same network. So this is how we're going, when we create a share, it's going to be given an IP address that's addressable over that network. So now what we need to do is we need to go add access for those IP addresses for guests 1 and 7. So I mentioned that's 10.0.0.2 and 10.0.0.6. So we'll let the animation go here for a second. So we'll click on the More button here, click on Manage Rules, which is where you define the IP-based access. So we'll type in the first IP address, click Apply. We'll see that it gets created and then goes to an active state. The interesting thing to note here is that the creation of a rule is immediate. It goes back to the backend controller to have the access rule actually set. So it's being enforced at the storage subsystem, not at the instance level. So we'll go in and we'll add the next IP address. We'll click Add. The same entitlement is set on the storage system. And then what we'll do is we'll actually log into these instances. They're all running on, in this particular case, a DevStack node. So we'll log in. We'll create a directory to mount the NFS share. So we'll call it research data since we're attaching the R&D data to that. We then need to know what the mount string to pass, the mount command that has the IP address of the share as well as the export path. So we'll go back to the shares menu, click in the detailed view, and we have the export location that's there. We'll simply cut and paste that in, give it the directory of /mount/research data. We'll click enter since we've already given access to the IP address of this particular instance. It's immediately mounted. There's no other steps that are required, so this is how you would typically do this. You could go and put this in FS tab and deal with an auto mounter, et cetera, at this point because you have establish the linkage. You can see through DF that the share exists. It's got a certain amount of blocks that are already allocated to it. 1 gig was the size that was used. So we'll now log into it is going backwards. All right. So again, just to prove that this is real, we'll create a file, we'll write some data into it. It's a shared file system, so that handles the locking behind the scenes so that multiple people can read and write concurrently within the file system. So we'll write hello world into the file. We'll then read it to make sure that everything was fine. And now what we'll do is we'll switch into the other VM and log in and should be able to read the content of that guest one file that we've just created. So we'll switch, we'll go to .5, which is guest number 7. Log in, give the password. Again, create a mount point directory for that to go to. We've already got the IP and export path already in our clipboard, so we'll just simply paste it again, give the point to the directory. Now we've mounted it yet again. We'll change into it. We should see the guest one file that was created by the other VM. It's there, we can read it. And see the hello world statement. We can then write our own message. We can just copy the file over, append to it to note that we're from a different VM. And this is all fairly just standard NFS stuff. So we've created a share, we've mounted it. We can now access it from multiple different VMs. So the second step here is just to go back and you see the file there that was created from guest 7 and guest 1. So we know that the share is actually accessible by both nodes. Both nodes are able to read and write to it. And away we go. So that was a share that already existed within the context of Manila. So now what we're going to do is address this other use case where someone wants to come in and create a new share and attach it to two other VMs. So what we'll do is we'll go back to the shares menu. We'll click on the create share button. We're given a wizard that's pretty typical for Horizon. We'll type in the name of the share, whether we want the protocol to be NFS or CIFS. We'll specify the size of the share that we want created, and then also creating an association with the shared network that we've defined. So again, making sure that we have isolation to the correct network where the share will be created and offered versus where the instances reside so that they can connect to it. So we see that it's gone and created, so this is actually then invoking the driver that exists that will handle the logic of actually creating the share, and we see that it's available. We'll then just go in and edit the access rules directly as we did before, giving the IP addresses of guest 6 and guest 8. So we'll quickly do that. And again, once we've done this, we'll log into the virtual machines and just make sure that now that we've created this new share that didn't exist before, that we're able to access it and do a simple I/O. So one thing to note here is we'll create a different directory, but we'll have to go back to Horizon and get the mount string since this is a separate share. It's going to have a separate IP address and separate export path. You may have noticed before that the actual unique ID for the share is embedded inside the export path. So it's simple to be able to make at least a visual linkage of I created this particular share with this ID. Is it where I've mounted it? So we'll simply cut and paste that in, attach it to the marking data directory, and that mount is successful. We can go into it. Again, we created that as a 1 gig, and you can see here that we have 1,008 megs of space, a gig of capacity for that particular share. So again, we'll simply just write a file and show that everything is working fine. We'll log into the second node, again, using the same mount string from the other VM. And again, we're able to see guest 6's file there, and we'll copy it and make it change the text so that it's guest 8, and there we go. So the last thing I want to note here in the demo is that you can see at on the overview chart, that we have a marker for the number of shares that are allocated, the amount of space that those shares consume, as well as the number of share networks. You can set quotas around all these things in the same way that you can around instances and volumes with Cinder and whatnot. So with that, we'll switch over to Greg and he'll give us an overview of kind of what are the key concepts within within Manila.
Manila and its key concepts. Manila exposes network shares, so the first key concept it is a share. It's an instance of a specific shared file system that's expressed on the filer. The share can have the size, access protocol, share type, and it can be accessed concurrently by multiple users because, after all, this is a shared network file system. The share can have access rules set on it. These are share level permissions about who can mount the shares and do things with it. Right now, the rules are based on the IP information. However, work is in progress on making the share accessible by LDAP users and groups. The share can have a presence on a specific network, because remember, the shares are expressed in the tenant space. So it defines a specific L2 and an L3 segment, so neutral network and the subnet. And right now, the share can only be associated with a single network. One of the important things is to present a security service. This is a tenant's own security service that will allow tenant to create a mapping for the users in that share. You can use LDAP, Active Directory, and you can actually, the API allows you to associate a share with multiple security services at once. If your backend supports it. Not all backends do. In addition to security service, we have the ability to do snapshots. Right now, they're read-only, and you can create a share from the snapshot as well. Backend, of course, defines which specific filer represents that share. And the driver is a specific piece of code created by the vendors in order to be able to plug in their implementation. The reference Linux driver exists, as well as a number of large number of vendor drivers have already been developed. So let's go quickly through the basic CRUD operations. There's no surprises there. With the shares, you can create, delete, list the shares. Obviously, you can show the share details, rename the shares, and as any OpenStack object, shares have metadata which you can view and edit. On the on access and the network side, you can allow share access, deny share access, like I said before, based either on the sitter information right now or eventually on the identity of the user. And obviously, you can list the accesses so you know what operations you've done. On the networks, share is associated with a network, so creating a share network means simply associating a share with a specific existing and neutral network. You can delete this association, list them, and you can activate the share network, which will have Neutron plug the port in.
Yeah. So next, Ben will talk about the kind of the process structure as well as the architecture of Manila.
Yeah, so Greg just introduced a number of concepts. Are there any questions in the room before we go into the architecture? You know, you can use the mic if you want to ask questions. Otherwise, we can save until the end. Okay. So I'm Ben Swartzlander. I mentioned the PTL for Manila. Can you hear me all right? Okay. So if you know the architecture for Cinder, you know the architecture for Manila. It's the same. For those of you that don't, I'll talk through it. Most important thing to know is that Manila is not in the data path. Manila is about command and control, you know, management and automation of shared file systems. There's an API service, which is how the outside world interacts with Manila, REST APIs. There's a scheduler service that makes decisions about where to put things, and that has a certain amount of intelligence that's programmable. There's a database that stores the state. There's a message bus that the services use to communicate with each other. And then there's a bunch of Manila share services, which is where all the magic happens. Each Manila share service has an instance of a driver, which is responsible for translating requests from the user into actual operations on whatever storage backend that driver supports. So while the architecture of Manila is very similar to Cinder, the main difference between Manila and Cinder is the fact that it cares very much about multi-tenancy and networking. Because it's providing the share all the way from the storage backend through to the guest network, it matters what type of multi-tenancy abstraction you're using within OpenStack. And OpenStack supports the concept of flat networking or segmented networking, either through VLANs, GRE tunnels, VXLANs, et cetera. The other wrinkle that Manila has to deal with is that while some storage backends have native support for multi-tenancy, not all of them do. And we don't want to leave anyone out. So Manila has mechanisms to help other backends also support multi-tenancy. And I'll go through all the different scenarios that we support. So if you're using a flat network and using a backend that doesn't support any native multi-tenancy, it's simple. You just use a single instance of the storage controller on the back end, and everyone shares the data on the network, and it's not particularly secure, but if for a private cloud use case, this may be perfectly adequate. If you're using a flat network and you have a storage controller which does support multi-tenancy, you get a little bit more separation in that each tenant will have their own instance of the storage server, but they'll all be on the same network. So you don't get complete isolation, but you get somewhat better isolation. If you're using network segmentation, like VLANs within your cloud, and you have a storage controller which supports native multi-tenancy, then Manila takes care of actually creating virtual storage server instances, provisioning them IP addresses through Neutron, connecting those storage server instances to the Neutron network, and ensuring that you have connectivity all the way through from the storage backend to the tenant network. And then the third case, if you have a segmented network and you're using a storage backend that doesn't have any support for native multi-tenancy, this doesn't exist yet. This is sort of in a prototype stage. Manila will create a gateway such that there's a bridge VM that sits between the tenant's network and the backend network, and it provides access to only the shares that the specific tenant is allowed to see. And that code is based on the generic driver, which I'll talk about later. Another difference between Manila and Cinder is the issue of mounting the shares that you create. So one of the great things about Cinder is, you know, you do a Cinder attach, volume just pops up in your VM. That's great. Because Manila is actually providing shared storage all the way from the back end through to the guest, and the hypervisor isn't involved, there is a manual step at the end to mount it on the guest, and you know that was illustrated during the demo. Obviously, this is something that users want to automate. It's something that we're interested in automating. We have a couple of ideas from the community on how to do this. We haven't done anything yet. One idea is integration with CloudInit to at boot time get a list of shares that should be connected to this host, and automate the mount process at boot time. The problem with that is, of course, then if you create a new share while the host is running, it's still manual. We've considered maybe having a user-space daemon that Manila can poke to make it mount new shares as they're created. That has security concerns associated with it. And there's the whole issue of having, maintaining a separate code base for this little daemon. So I'm not sure if that'll be an accepted solution. Another possibility is having Manila SSH directly to the boxes and issue the mount commands itself. That worked great for Linux, not so well for Windows. But we'll probably end up implementing some or all of these schemes, and we're looking for great ideas. If anyone has a better solution to this problem, join the community, contribute. We're looking for solutions to some of these trickier problems. So I'm going to switch gears and start talking about the drivers. I'll first talk about the generic driver. The generic driver is in many ways the most important driver within Manila, because it's the one that will be run as part of the CI system. It's the first driver that many users will probably experience when they install DevStack and just try it out. It's 100% software, open source. The way that the generic driver works is that when Manila gets a request to create storage, it will create a Nova VM that's not owned by the tenant, and it will create two network interfaces, one connected to the tenant network and one connected to the backend network, and then it will create a sender volume to actually store the data. It'll format it ext4, and then install it. It will use NFSD or Samba, whatever it needs to do to actually provide the share service onto the tenant network. And these VMs are reusable, so if you ask for multiple shares, Manila will only create one VM, and then multiple shares can be served from a single VM. And all of the communication between Manila and the VM is over SSH, and the actual glance image that runs on the generic Nova VM is it's customizable. You can run whatever flavor of Linux you want. You can patch it, install stuff on it. The Manila team provides a reference implementation of the generic driver image that's based on CIROS, the well-known, extremely stripped-down Linux instance that we all use in our DevStack instances, as a reference implementation for the generic driver. Any questions about this before I hand it over to Tushar? You want to use the mic?
Can I create a share and then export it to some instance which is outside of OpenStack, say a bare metal Linux server running somewhere else?
Yeah, absolutely. So as Bob indicated in the demo, when you actually, the only thing that Manila cares about is the share network, which can exist inside Neutron. Well, it has to exist inside Neutron, but the network doesn't necessarily have to be a Nova network. It can be a network that contains bare metal. And then the access rules are just IP addresses, which can be IP addresses of anything. Doesn't necessarily have to be an instance. So the answer is yes.
Can you clarify, you said something about using Samba or SMB. How does that work?
So the goal of Manila is to support all shared file systems. The two most well-known shared file systems are NFS and CIFS or Samba or SMB. There are other shared file systems out there like CEFFS, like GlusterFS, like GPFS. That we intend to support all of them. And the generic, although individual backends won't support all of them. For example, the NetApp backend won't support GlusterFS. right now, the generic backend only supports CIFS and NFS. Those are the two most common ones. You could imagine extensions to support other ones.
Yeah, so the generic driver basically will spin up NFSD or the Samba daemon within that Nova instance based on the protocol choice that was made by the client. Okay. But to support those two protocols. Does that answer your question? All right, so Tushar? Oh, we have one more?
Yeah, I had one question. It looked like the protocol was a property on the share creation as opposed to being something at attachment time. So does that mean that shares can only be attached via one protocol?
Yes, today's shares are single protocol. We know that some backends have support for multi-protocol. We haven't figured out how to expose that through Manila yet. That's a future thing. Definitely valuable. but it doesn't exist yet.
You mentioned snapshots. Is that snapshot of the file system, or is it a glance-based snapshot?
It's a snapshot of the whole share. So, yeah, if you have a 1 gig file system, it'll take a snapshot of all the files in that file system.
I didn't see it in your list of APIs.
The list of APIs wasn't a complete list because that would be very long.
Yeah, it's not meant to be the definitive documentation of this. I mean, we certainly have the code there. It's more just to give you a sense of this is how it looks and feels. It's not dissimilar. The CRUD style operations as well as these constructs are directly accessible over REST, over CLI, through Horizon, et cetera.
All right, I'll hand it over to Tushar to talk about the Gluster driver.
Thank you, man. Let's click. Hello, everyone. I'm here to talk about what is Red Hat and Manila doing together, and talk about the Gluster driver for Manila. Basically, for those of you who don't know what Gluster is, it's a distributed file system. And so as a result, we have a lot of interest, as you can imagine, in Manila and the file sharing business. So what we have today really is a single tenant driver. It's a GlusterFS driver which uses Gluster NFS, which is a userland NFS implementation for Gluster. So Gluster natively can export its namespace via NFS, and that driver is called Gluster NFS. And what we're going to do in the future, obviously, single tenant is not going to cut it. So we're working on a multi-tenant driver that uses what is known as NFS Ganesha, which is a NFS v4 implementation in user land. It's a community project. And so we're going to use that. And it's multi-tenant, and so we can use that to provide a multi-tenant driver in the future. So that's a quick overview of what we are up to. So this is just a quick representation of what it means if you use the current GlusterFS driver. Most of it, I'm not going to belabor the whole thing because I think it fits into exactly what these gentlemen described earlier, but just so in terms of what we do on the Gluster side is you can see here in the blue box, there's a Gluster Manila volume, which is the global namespace that we have exported via NFS. And so when you get a Manila create for a marketing share or a sales share, we create a subdirectory underneath it. And then when the Manila access allows us to basically provide access to the particular IP addresses that require that share. So that's in a nutshell. So essentially what you can do is you can go to individual guests and provide access to particular shares similar to what was described earlier. So nothing there. So again, like I said, I think the future for us is to provide the multi-tenant GlusterFS driver, and that's work in progress, as well as to migrate to NFS Ganesha, which I talked to you earlier about. So with that, I'll hand it over to
Rob.
Rob.
Okay. May I have that? Thanks. So just a bit about a number of the things that we're looking at when it comes to engaging in Manila. So, you know, our systems have a legacy of, you know, a rich set of capabilities associated with shared file system deployment, whether that be NFS or CIFS. The intent is to leave none of that behind. Don't allow Manila to actually abstract those capabilities. So one of the things that we haven't talked about yet that should be a near-term evolution is applying the same sort of construct that you see in Cinder, namely the type construct where you can build a catalog of capabilities and deliver it in the context of Manila so that you could compose, for example, a particular backend, or rather you could create a catalog that says, you know, give me a something that has deduplication and compression or others that are on a particular media type. It's arbitrary in the sense that the administrator can define what the catalog looks like. And so all of those sort of capabilities on that prior slide, the intent on our part is to leave none of it behind, make it explicitly accessible. When Ben mentioned that the reference or the generic driver is in many ways very, very important, and that's mostly from a developer-centric perspective, certainly from a ongoing development, submission, testing via CI, Tempest and such. Yes, true, but from a deployment perspective, I'd argue that one of the implementations that the folks here on this stage of sorts are talking about are going to be almost certainly the more obvious choice for real-world deployment, and that they're going to offer that differentiated set of capabilities over that kind of lowest common denominator generic driver. talking about clustered ONTAP, a little bit of frankly, I could be very long-winded about the slide, so let me just be, let's distill it. Clustered ONTAP is a scale-out operating system, storage operating system that exists over many nodes. We virtualize the network, we virtualize the disk, or the storage containers, rather, and of course the storage controllers themselves. And they can move from one side to the other, you can move storage in and out. And another aspect, as it applies to Manila specifically, is that you can have supply multiple different, if you will, IO engines into a single, for example, NFS namespace. You have a global namespace that applies to all of these individual things. So it's not your, if you will, father's NFS. And when you apply a parallelized NFS on top of that, then you get a distributed IO characteristic. You don't have this common problems of fanning and whatnot. So these SVMs are measures of inherent secure multi-tenancy. And so when we talk about the Manila implementations that actually already exist for clustered ONTAP, namely CIFS and NFS, and with NFS you get parallelized NFS as an option as well, to the extent that your clients, your hosts that are interacting with Manila can support it. We basically map when we create a Manila share specifically to that multi-tenant construct, that SVM, and those network interfaces are secure to that specific storage virtual machine. So you have like a strong measure of separation from one tenant to the next. You layer that in along with sort of that distributed IO characteristic, the horizontal scaling characteristics, a cluster on top, and the ability through the typing mechanism to get at the differentiated set of characteristics. I'd argue that might be among the more important options of certainly the other folks here on the stage represented as well. And with that, EMC.
Thanks, Ron. So EMC's implementation in Manila actually is, from a driver perspective, what we decided to do is build a common driver and support each product because we have multiple file offerings as well via a plugin architecture, if you will. So the initial implementation of the plugins is for our VNX and Isilon product lines, with, of course, more to come in the future as well. So if we talk about what VNX is our scale-up offering. And from the VNX perspective, effectively, we are support a similar construct to a storage VM, what we call the virtual data mover. And today, we have a prototype driver available already, which isn't contributed yet, but we're hoping to change that soon. And the prototype driver allows us to specify either a virtual data mover or a physical data mover today, along with the network IP address that should be used. Going forward in the future, we plan on implementing some of the share network share APIs as well, and automating the creation of storage VMs or virtual data movers, as well as the virtual interfaces required to support that tenant network as well. From the EMC Isilon side, which is our scale-out platform, we basically have a single namespace, and what we do there is we basically create a new export and assign a quota to it, and that quota is then available as a share. And again, just like the VNX, it already supports the majority of the Manila API, although, likewise, it uses host ACL for both SMB and NFS. Going forward into the future, again, just like the VNX, we're still evolving to the multi-tenancy APIs. So what we're going to do there is we're going to use our Smart Connect and Access Zone features to facilitate multi-tenancy in Isilon as well. As well as we have some QoS investigation to do. As Rob said, once we get further along with volume types, hopefully we'll be able to leverage some of that stuff as well. So with that, I'll pass it on to MEM.
Hi, I'm Dean Hildebrand at IBM Research. So GPFS is IBM's scale-out file system. It's used in numerous products that IBM sells. But for here, we're just focusing on the actual core file system. We can support multiple backends, and we really like Manila as a way to, well, as something that we see is missing across all virtualization solutions today, but also as a way to get our customers, you know, into OpenStack and, you know, moving them from bare metal and into VMs or the mix of the two. We would like to support both the clustered NFS solution that we have with GPFS, which includes PNFS as well as doing native GPFS support in Manila. You know, and then by enabling this, we can take advantage of all the features that we can today, but also give users a way to manage and use the storage that we have for all, available. We also have a Cinder driver today, and we also see this as yet another one of the features that then can be tacked on to this same data plane that users can use as we keep adding these features. We have a prototype available today that works with NFS. It's also not yet available, but something that we want to contribute as soon as we return home and get back to real work.
All right, great. Thanks, Dean. So, you know, in terms of where the project is today, you know, we've been to the technical committee once to talk about what it would take to get the official incubation tag put up behind Manila. You know, we went through a few list of items. I think we've largely completed those. So you should expect that official status to be denoted with Manila during the Juno timeframe. We have at least from a NetApp perspective, I mean, I can't have a customer conversation these days where Manila does not come up. I know that that's very similar with EMC and others. So a large number of POCs. We have some that are already occurring today, a long list of people that want to get started with it. So certainly are trying to gather that user input to affect the development process, make sure that we understand what the right priorities of items are. Currently today, what we're thinking about focusing in the Juno release, as Ben had mentioned, the notion of a gateway-based multi-tenancy to align perhaps differing approaches to network segmentation as well as the multi-tenancy support that a particular storage vendor may supply, so making sure that we have the ability to map those together. The notion of the type support that was discussed prior so that you could create a catalog of share services. The notion of supporting multiple different vendor backends and subsequently vendor drivers within a particular deployment of Manila—it's something that works in Cinder today. I think there's a little bit of work left to be done to get that enabled and fully vetted within Manila. And then we're also going to continue to investigate the automation of mounting shares as Ben went through before. So that's kind of the depth approach. Also, we're seeing a breadth in terms of the different integration points that are being explored. So more vendors, more backends, and more protocols. So the notions of CIFS, GPFS, other shared file systems are being kicked around in discussions and meetings, and we expect to see those mature here in the Juno timeframe. So with that, obviously we would encourage you to get involved with Manila if it's of interest to you. As we mentioned before, we've got you know, this is already live on StackForge. It's developed under the normal OpenStack processes, so there's nothing unusual. The demo that I built was actually on a DevStack instance. If you go to the Manila wiki that I've linked here on the chart, there's a new page called Icehouse DevStack that lists out the instructions. So it's very simple for you to integrate this into your local conf or local RC, run stack.sh, and you have the actual horizon and command line and API endpoints that we've talked about today. So very easy to get started. We actually even have an IRC channel where several of us sit in that channel regularly, as well as having weekly meetings. So more, you know, the typical OpenStack process for developing a project, that's what we're following, so nothing unusual there. This afternoon, we're actually having a design session. Due to space issues, we're actually going to not be in the World Congress building. We'll be up the street a little bit at Stats Sports Bar. They have a private room that we've reserved. So from 4 to 5 today, happy to have folks come in from a development perspective. We're going to be talking about some technical issues around Juno as well as some blueprints. So want to make sure that folks are aware of that session. And if you're interested to come, feel free to join. So with that, we've got a few minutes left for questions. I'm happy to take those. Yeah, if you do have questions, please come up to the mic so everyone can hear.
So for storage systems which have both block and file support, is it possible to have a common driver which supports both sender and Manila, or we need to have separate drivers?
So you can.
Presently.
Okay. Oh, did you want to talk? Let me defer to the PTL. Yes. Ben Schwartzlander.
So the short answer is not today. So because of the commonality between sender and Manila, we see down the road merging of that kind. But today, the code bases are separate.
Yeah, the code bases are separate is what's Ben saying. I think his mic's not working. But
That's an immense topic unto itself. So yes, in the here and now, separate. You could certainly go a long way down that path to this notion of a single object and duality of access to it, but that's not where we're at. In the here and now, completely separate, different capacity pools, or maybe even the same capacity pool vended in different ways, yes, but in terms of, you know, control plane into it and access into it, different.
And volume type will be called volume type or share type? I mean, what's the nomenclature?
What do you think? Yeah. Sounds like a share type menu, but
yeah, I think
Ben thinks fall type.
Yeah, so right now I think it's the code says volume type. If you have an opinion, feel free to bring that to the IRC channel to write a blueprint. So there's been some discussion on that in the community to date, but again, it's not a dictatorship, right? It's a community. So if you have a different proposal,
I mean, if I go to Cinder and I see volume type, and if I go to Manila and see the same volume type, but they are different, it will be quite confusing.
So. Yeah, no, yeah. There are lots of us that agree. So thanks.
Hi, are there any plans to integrate some form of access control other than by IP address, like certificates or any more generalized security infrastructure?
Yeah, sure. So Ben, do you want to talk about that?
Well, so because Manila connects the file system all the way through from the controller to the user, all the regular file system security protocols apply. So, you know, if you're using CIFS and you have an Active Directory domain, you know, the access is through Active Directory. And you as the tenant supply your Active Directory parameters to Manila so that when it creates a CIFS share for you, that server is part of your Active Directory domain. So it's all it's all controlled per tenant, and you have all of that, all of the security. The same would be true with NFS. So if you're using Kerberos security with NFS, all you have to do is tell Manila the IP address of your Kerberos server, the IP address of your LDAP server, all the usernames and passwords that it needs to know so that it can join that domain. And then you can use, you know, Kerberized NFS and have secure access that way.
Yeah, so that was that concept of security service. We didn't touch on it in the demo, but that's the object where you would define those relationships for Active Directory, LDAP, and CURB.
Another question, you showed that the user actually needs to do two things. One, it needs to list the IP addresses of the clients. The second thing, it needs to mount the target from the client. Now, the IP addresses could be pretty dynamic. You could use DHCP in Neutron or things like that. So why not do attach, from the VM side, attach a share, and then automatically figure out the address. Maybe the address haven't been even allocated yet, because once the instance will go up, it will be allocated.
So that would be integration with Nova, which hasn't been done yet, but obviously we can.
The second thing of export is simpler, because you basically do the same thing in all shares with a fixed address.
But right,
the critical part is the IP address of the client in the access control. That should be automated probably.
Yeah, the intention is that Manila can provide shares to Nova instances and to other things. So in the case where what you're sharing with is a Nova instance, we would want to provide that kind of integration, and that would be changes to the Nova project to enable that.
It could even save you the need to specify the network, because in Nova you would have an interface. So once you do attach from maybe potentially an interface, you could actually know also the network.
Right. I mean, an instance can have multiple attachments to multiple networks as well. And then in case, where do you want the plumbing to be done? So I think it's a great comment in terms of, could you specify an instance ID versus an IP address initially? I think probably a variety of options might make sense there.
There's an issue with the order of operations. You have to create the share before you can attach it. And at the time you create it, the network that it's going to exist on matters when you're scheduling it. So if you know the instance ahead of time before you even create it, maybe you can feed that in. But if you create a share with no network attached to it, then we won't know where to put it, quite frankly.
Yes, you do the same with VMs. You don't necessarily, when you define a VM, you don't necessarily instantiate it in the same point. So you have to have sort of an event notification when the instance actually goes up and gets the IP. And I think this is from a user perspective. That's really the problem. You're expecting to put the IP address, which wasn't even defined yet in some cases.
I think you have some valid points, and we welcome you to the Manila development community. And we'll be happy to discuss in greater detail at 4 o'clock at Stats. I just wanted to offer a little time for some of the other folks.
Is Manila or will Manila be compatible with CIFS?
So we've talked to the CIFS guys, and we intend to support CIFS alongside all the other protocols. So far, there hasn't been any participation in the community from them, but they've expressed an intent to do so, and we want to welcome them.
Anything you want to add, Tushar, to that?
No, I mean, I don't know more than that. I mean, I talked to Neil. I saw him just earlier, so if he's still around, he might be able to comment. But I don't see him anymore. But I think that's exactly it. I mean, that is the intention. It's just not happening.
Okay. Thank you very much.
So one question. So apart from the VM instances themselves, do you see any other consumers of the Manila shares, like some other services, Heat, Sahara, or anything else?
Yeah, absolutely. So Cinder can actually be used outside of the context of OpenStack, and the intention is for Manila to be usable outside of the context of OpenStack if you want to. You can use it to vend storage to anything. There's a model where you can actually run Cinder on top of Manila. If you're using an NFS-based Cinder driver, you could use Manila to create the shares and then put Cinder on top of that and use that to create volumes, which is sort of the opposite of the generic driver use case. You could use it to provide storage to databases or to Sahara.
Yeah, think of defining a heat template for a traditional Oracle workload, right, where I may have an NFS share for the data and an NFS share for the logs, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, right? So I could define that actually as a heat template, connecting that in, so you could pull multiple shares and have it all be, deployed by that click in the button to create that stack. So.
How do you see the integration points with heat going? If someone wants to like allocate a cluster and a share and all that stuff all at one point.
I'm sorry.
I didn't quite catch the first part of that question.
Well, how would you allocate shares in a heat template down the road? I know it's not there yet, but how would you see integration with heat working?
I mean, at least in some concept, very similar to what Cinder has done, right? I mean, it's at the outset, it's not too different. Certainly, the networking component would have to be specified to make sure that the linkage would occur correctly. But the primitives of I want a share, I want this protocol or this share type and this size, and to have that directly mapped to the correct instance IDs. Perhaps the question before around specifying the IP addresses, that could all be automated by heat underneath the cover so that you don't have to worry about it. That's how I would envision it initially. Would look very similar to Cinder, and perhaps some of those orchestrations of the subsequent access rules and security services would just be automatically done.
So with the generic driver, I saw that you guys spin up another VM to create that, to talk to Cinder and then connect to the network.
Yep.
So that seems like that will be, I guess, the single point of failure or a choke point. So mm-hmm. How are you guys envisioning how to handle a large amount of bandwidth say that has to go through that.
Yeah, I think that goes back to a point Rob made earlier, right? It's the reference implementation is a way to get started to understand how it works. It's not necessarily what we would recommend to put into into production, in the sense of, obviously, it's a single point of failure, single VM, no load balancer, not optimized from a throughput perspective at all, more just to instantiate the concept. I mean, you look at Cinder, there's a reference implementation that exists there. Some people use it by default, some people don't. But it's more meant to just be a way to use Manila by itself without having to purchase or deploy a vendor product here in order to access it, if that makes sense.
Yeah, that makes sense. It's just if we want to keep
I mean, it's something we can certainly look at. I mean, yeah. Instead of just deploying a single VM, perhaps we could deploy a heat template that would give you that HA, that load balancing, auto scale, all those properties. So it's something we could certainly talk about. Yeah. The way it exists today, keep it simple when you start.
No, absolutely.
So it's a single VM with a Cinder volume, and the Cinder volume matches the size of the share that you wanted. So it's a fairly clean mapping, but not meant to be, ready for production.
Awesome. Thank you.
Sure.
So I noticed the Nova Compute that spun up in the reference implementation is not put in the tenant that creates it. So where does that go?
It goes into a particular service tenant. So the same tenant that the actual Manila service is registered within Keystone.
Yeah, so I didn't cover this during the talk. The Nova VM that's created by the generic driver and all of the Cinder volumes that are created by it are not owned by the tenant, both so that you don't accidentally delete them and you don't see them in your lists, but more importantly, they don't count against your quotas, right? Because you have separate quotas for shares and presumably separate billing if you're doing some sort of a chargeback. So you don't want to double charge people for the VMs and the storage that are being consumed by Manila if you're using the generic driver.
Yeah. All right. Any other questions from folks? All right, one thing to remind you, we do have a survey on the tables that we'd appreciate if you guys would fill out just to give us some feedback and just drop those off or hand them to folks as you walk out the door. We'd really appreciate folks filling those out. And thanks for coming.